Looking Glass, for a show that's all about reflections. On reflection, it's Joe Lycett. Reflecting on what she's done, Liza Tarbuck.
Thank you.
Reflecting the mood of the nation, it's Zoe Lyons. And next year's wreath lecturer, okay, oh. Alan Davis. Their buzzers are reflecting off a rock face. Joe goes...
Joe.
Lisa goes...
Lisa.
Zoe goes...
Zoe.
And Alan goes...
Alan, what?
As you can see, we have made this episode a mirror image of what you usually see, which is to say that, Alan, we have put you on the opposite side to usual. How many years in the other chair?
18.
Does it feel weird?
It does feel weird. Yeah. You look a little bit different from this side.
Is that a good thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, no, it's not like, oh my God.
Yeah. Right, here is a question. Why do mirrors flip you side to side and not upside down?
That's very good, yes.
Yes, why is it?
Two eyes. It must be because your eyes are level.
Okay, let us imagine that we are looking at writing on a T-shirt. Okay, yeah. And you can read it perfectly well. And then you look in a mirror, the writing on the T-shirt appears to be flipped.
That way.
Back to, like that. So you can see it's left, back to front. Yeah, why is that? Why does the mirror do that? And why does it not flip us upside down as well? Why does it only flip as apparently left to right?
Is it not what Alan said about your eyes being left and right?
I like your eyes are on the side of your head when you do that.
Yeah.
like a fish.
Is your eye seeing actually what it is? Does your brain... Does your brain flip it?
Have you had a stroke?
Yeah.
When it comes in your eye, it's already flipped.
Right.
And your brain flips it around.
What he said. That's what
I think everybody is making it much too complicated. So, here's what we're going to do. We're going to try this, and Joe is going to be my assistant. Joe, I want you to take a piece of card that we have got here.
Yes.
Write a large, clear word in capital letters.
Oh, my God, are you going to try and guess it?
No, I don't want to guess it. It's not a magical trick.
What's the point, then? I want a magic trick.
OK, Liza, could you... Any word, darling. What about the word boss, for example, which, you know, lots of people have a boss, right?
Looks like we're off to court.
Yeah. Right, and can you write the same word on this piece of glass? OK, so I am going to go over here and stand in front of the camera and the glass, and you can see, hopefully... Are the audience able to see this? Can you see it on the monitors, everybody? So you can see that it says boss. Now, when I have it, as it were, on my T-shirt and I look in the mirror, it is... it's flipped round, OK?
Yeah.
So the question is, why does it do that? Well, the mirror hasn't done anything. It was me who flipped it round. There is absolutely nothing happening in the mirror. If you look at the card, I am flipping it around. The mirror has not done anything. And, in fact, if you bring the glass, darling, bring the piece of glass over here. Have you written the same word on the piece of glass?
Yeah.
OK, so come here, my darling. Let's put the card behind it. Let us imagine there it is. Can you see that perfectly well? There it says boss. But if I don't flip it around now, because it's written on glass, when we look in the mirror, it is perfectly fine. The mirror has not done anything. It is me who did the flipping around. Thank you, my darling. The most brilliant magician's assistant there. Fantastic. could try and imagine if you were a fish and you had your eyes on either side of your head and the fish... Have we got a picture of a fish swimming? There we go. So a fish swimming alongside a mirror would see the eye exactly where it's supposed to be and the tail exactly where it's supposed to be. It would know that the mirror has done nothing. The flipping is done by us and not by the mirror.
I don't think I've ever questioned that.
No, and then actually once you do start thinking about it, it does slightly do your head in.
So hang on, is Alan over there because I've done it in my head?
Yes.
Everyone's done me in their head, Chuck.
Do you know what? I haven't, but I am now. And...
Is there a mirror?
There is another thing that curious about mirrors. If you've got, you should each have a mirror there.
Mm.
If you, and you could try this when you have a mirror at home. Hold it quite close to your face, okay? Look at one or other of your eyes in the reflection. Just choose one. If you then transfer your gaze to the other eye, you will not see your eyes move, although somebody watching would see the movement quite clearly.
Oh, that's so weird.
That is quite strange, isn't it?
It bulged forward as well.
What, your eye?
No, my whole... the whole part of that part of my face.
I think that's a medical condition that... so, I mean, try it. It's a very... it's a curious thing.
Scream!
Do you know... you know what? I've suddenly... this is my fifth year hosting and I expect all trouble to come from my right and today it's from my left. It's a very strange thing. Here's a question for you. If I'm in a box with a mirrored...
You'd be much taller.
If I made a box with a mirrored interior and we shone a light into it and we closed it, does the light keep bouncing around forever?
Are you in the box?
Yeah, I'm in the box with a small torch. Right, let's work it that way.
Yeah.
We just bang on the box and go, Sandy.
If I turn
Sandy, can you see a light?
If I turn the torch on and then I turn it off again, will it bounce around forever?
No.
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 Why not?
Well, I don't know. I'd love you to tell me.
It's because no mirror reflects 100% of the light striking it. So some of it is absorbed and eventually, I mean, actually unbelievably quickly, because it's millions of times per second, it would be absorbed by the mirror and it would leave the interior completely dark. It's a miracle that we can work out what's going on in a reflection at all. What can this fish do that a baby can't?
Stay underwater.
Yeah, swim underwater is absolutely true. Yes, there used to be a myth that babies could do that, but that is not believed.
No, I learned that out the hard way.
Yeah.
Three nieces was too many anyway.
No, fair enough.
Yeah.
Anybody know what kind of fish this is?
Stripey.
Stripey fish.
Cleaner fish.
It's a cleaner fish. Cleaner fish. It is. It is. It's a cleaner wrasse.
Is it something to do with reflections? Because that is the... topic.
Yes. So well can... done, Joe, for paying attention.
Can it recognise itself in a mirror because babies can't?
Correct. It's one of the very few animals, in fact, it's the very first fish to pass what's called the mirror test to recognise its reflection of itself.
How do you test that?
Well, so what you do is you mark the animal in a place where it can only see the mark in a mirror. So, for example, the forehead would be a good place, and then see whether or not it observes it and whether or not it tries to scratch it to remove it.
We'll have a job, though, Sandy, won't it? Trying to scratch that off with no hands, right?
Except that... cleaning off marks, Zoe, is what it does for a living.
For a living?
Yeah, they do actually have stations, and the clients, as it were, come to the station to be cleaned. They work for about 4 hours a day, and they clean about 2,000 clients. So it does seem like, when you're looking at them, as if it's a job. But that's what they do for a living. That's it, inside the mouth of a Rankin cod. Look at that picture. I think it's so exciting.
There's got to be a lot of trust, hasn't there?
A
really?
Lot of trust, except that... all of the fish that are cleaned end up living longer and they tend to be smarter because they don't have the parasites. I mean, there is a sort of a caveat with this. It's possible that what the wrasse is actually doing is signalling to the other wrasse, in the mirror, if you see what I mean, that it ought to clean itself. It actually doesn't see that it's itself. It's going to the other rash. You've got a little something. You've just got... you've got a little something here, so it may not be aware that it's a mirror image of itself.
When do babies start to recognise...
About the age of two.
Right.
I really think it'd be sooner than that. My daughter, she knew the way to the city farm when she was one and a half.
Was she trying to get away?
She was.
There's actually very few species that pass the test. Great apes mostly do, but not gorillas. And what I love is that animals do exactly what humans do when they discover a mirror for the very first time. First of all, an animal would look behind it to see if there's an animal behind it, and then they'll do funny movements, like we do in the fun fair, to see what it is. And then they will indulge in the same behaviour as an office worker left alone with a photocopier. Well, see parts of their body they've not been able to look at before. I know, yeah.
It's a miracle we don't have more mirrored seating, really, isn't it?
No, I don't think it is, really.
Some people like a mirrored chair.
That would...
You'd get some very odd selfies then, wouldn't you? Is that for a dick pic?
Could you get a mirrored internal bowl of a toilet? Because that would be like a funfair mirror for your undercarriage, wouldn't it? Because that would have a curve to it.
You could definitely have a mirrored urinal. I can't see why you couldn't have that.
Yeah. Because sort of honestly,
shooting at yourself.
What is wrong with men?
We've just got a sense of fun.
A sense of fun, darling. You've actually got an aiming device that doesn't seem to work.
Oh, no, mine does. Mine does, because there's in one pub in London that I went to, there's like a game, and it's got sensors in the urinal, and I got the top score on the thing, and it asks you to put your name in, but I didn't want to put my name in, so I put Adrian Childs. There's a pub in central London where Adrian Childs has got a real reputation.
Recognising yourself in a mirror is a sign of exceptional intelligence. So well done to all our panel for getting through makeup tonight. Right, now, I'm going to make you write like Leonardo da Vinci. How do you think I am going to do that?
Did he...
Teach us Italian.
Did he write reflectively?
He read what's called mirror writing. So we are going to see if we can do this without thinking about it. Underneath the table, you will feel a piece of paper. And you should have a pen. Take the pen.
Yeah.
And I want you to write your names on the piece of paper as it is under the desk. So write your first name on the piece of paper. This looks so weird. Of all you've got... OK, so, done. OK, let's take them out and have a look. Let's start with Zoe. Let's have a look at yours.
Oh, that's pretty good for me.
OK. OK, but what is the thing about it that's interesting? Is it's back to front.
Some of it is.
Some
of it
the
isn't.
The O's not.
The O is exactly.
Well, how about you, Alan? Same for you? Oh, wow. Are you left-handed, Alan?
Nope.
That is...
I'm just a fucking genius.
What have you done?
Oh, yes. I've done mirror.
You've done mirror writing. Yeah. What about you, Joe? Wow, the boys...
I am left-handed, though.
You are left-handed.
Does that affect it?
Yes, I think it does. The brain is wired slightly differently.
Better?
It's an unusual demand, so it confuses our brain, so it's not unusual to do it as mirror writing. It's common in children who are learning to write.
I've gone half and half, then. What does that... Because that one's back to front, but that one's the right way around.
You're right to be disappointed. That's shit.
It is a bit...
Three letters. One of them's the same either way.
Yeah. So what's all this got to do with Leonardo da Vinci? Well, he wrote his personal notes in mirror writing, and nobody really knows why. Possibly for privacy. That is a possible thing. Maybe just to amuse himself. But he was left-handed. And my son is left-handed, and I asked him, and he said it's possible. He was just more comfortable. When the pen goes away from the body, as it does for a right-handed person when you're writing, it just feels better.
Well, so... no, also, I found when I was at school, particularly when you're using a fountain pen, that you smudge it as you go over it.
Yeah.
So that's... He was smart, wasn't he, Leonardo?
Yeah, well,
I think we haven't given him enough credit.
But we have a generally poor memory for the configuration of objects, so we're going to do a couple of quick tests to demonstrate. So, the audience, let's start with you. You've all seen the Statue of Liberty, I am sure. You've seen a picture of it 1,000 times. I want you to vote whether the statue holds the torch in the right or the left hand.
Oh, God.
So, hands up for right. And hands up for left. Well, I think left pretty much had the edge there, and the answer is it's in the right hand. OK, let's try the panel. So, we see fonts all the time now, that's the thing. Which of the four lowercase g's written on the screen is correct?
Number one.
Three.
One,
three,
four.
Anymore?
One and
four.
Two. One and two.
Two. Well, let's have the audience vote for number one. Hardly anybody. Number two. Quite a lot. Number three. Even more. Number four.
Oh, two.
Well, so none of us can really remember. The answer is number two. Number two is the correct way, yeah. But these are things we see all the time, yeah. And we have an inability to correctly recall the configuration of things. Now, which is better, symmetrical knees or symmetrical nostrils?
Ooh.
I know. Mm. Who would have thought there was a choice?
Which is better?
Yeah, which is better?
I'd say knees.
Why would you say knees?
To have your face exactly the same on both sides
is weird.
Would actually be really odd, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
No, I thought the height of beauty was having a symmetrical face.
OK, let's have a look at ourselves with symmetrical faces.
Oh, God.
Here we are. Oh, this is the left side of your faces replicated.
It's had more impact on your head, isn't it?
Good God.
I look terrified. I look like a chipmunk. So that's our left sides. Let's have a look at our right sides and see if we think that's any better.
Oh! That's amazing! Oh! Oh! Christ, you're straight out of Star Trek.
I come in peace.
Yeah. That is the weirdest thing. Alan, you don't look like yourself at all.
Oh, look at Alan. I feel really sad for him there. I don't know why.
They say that part of the attraction of a person is the symmetry of their face, but I'm not sure.
No!
I'm not sure that that is entirely true. Let's go back to knees and nostrils. So the answer is it depends what you want to do. So knees for a sprinter and nostrils for a distance runner. There's a man called Robert Trivers and lots of his colleagues, and they looked into Jamaican athletes in particular, and they found that symmetrical knees and ankles characterise sprinters and symmetrical nostrils do the same for distance runners. Why might that be?
Well, a sprinter, you are up and down and forward, aren't you?
Yeah.
It's an efficiency of
How
movement.
How are you sprinting?
Like that. Like that.
Like a train.
This is why I didn't make Team GB.
But you are a runner.
Yeah, I am a runner, but a plodder.
Symmetry is inherently efficient. So that's very useful for sprinting and breathing, much more important the longer distance that you run, so you're going to need better nostrils. Symmetry of feet apparently doesn't seem to matter to runners at all. Longer distance runners tend to have relatively asymmetric feet, actually. I couldn't work out whether that's because they go around on the track all the time. But in all of the groups, the left foot tends to be larger than the right in runners.
Wow.
My left foot's bigger than my right.
Is it? Considerably.
About half a size.
Good to know.
Oh. Weirdly, it's all on the back of the foot. The front of the foot's the same.
What, your heel? Mm. You've got a big bulging heel. Is that what you're saying?
It goes back about
6 inches. I've never noticed that.
I've got the effect of a kind of a rocking chair. If I wait at a bus stop, I can be quite alarming on one foot.
Anyway, you might think that symmetrical knees are caused by sprinting, but in fact, it can be used as a predictive measure. If you look at the relevant symmetry of a child at the age of 8, you can predict whether or not they're going to be a good sprinter. So it's not the training program that has changed their physiology, it's the fact that they already had symmetrical knees that's made them good at sprinting. Back in the day, what was the problem with watching snooker in the mirror?
It was in black and white.
Well, that is in a way correct.
Because you know, within football, they used to have a rule that if it was an international game, you couldn't have teams, even if they were in red and blue shirts, one of them had to change because
in many of the developing countries hadn't yet got colour television and they wanted to expand football around the world. And if you're watching the black and white, you couldn't tell the difference between one team and another.
So television sets in the early days were monochrome and so were the earliest mirrors. The reflections that they gave were effectively monochrome. Yes, because strong, bright colours were sort of dimly distinguishable, but subtle colour distinctions were really difficult, so a game of snooker watched in an early mirror would have been practically impossible.
Sorry, the mirror... The mirror made things black and white.
So the earliest mirrors are made of volcanic glass. It's something called obsidian. Have a look in this, Sterling, and you will see... So you have to imagine this is before the invention of being able to put silver on glass.
Before the invention of snooker, surely. Well...
Explain that the way snooker was viewed on television
on obsidian
would have been a bit like looking in an early mirror. Here you are. This is a piece of volcanic glass. It's naturally occurring, and that's a piece of obsidian glass up there. And you can see some bright colours, you can see some shapes dimly, but you are not able to distinguish subtlety of colour in any way.
That's the sort of mirror I want in my house. What you look at before you go out and go, I look cracking. I look like a shadow.
Yeah. So this is the sort of early stuff, and it's made when...
It's lovely, isn't it?
It's beautiful, isn't it? John Dee, who was the astrologer to Elizabeth I, and his assistant, Edward Keeley, used to use one for scrying. This, in fact, is his piece of glass that he used for scrying. Does anybody know what scrying is?
When you look at it and you're telling the future, so you'd scry with a crystal ball or you'd scry with a goblet with some water in
it. It's a form of divination. They called it a showstone. The process for actually silvering mirrors the way that we know them today was not invented until 1835. So before then, if you put hot metal on glass, it just basically broke. And that means that most people before mid-19th century had very little idea what they looked like.
What a relief.
Yeah. I know. I mean, that famous picture of Narcissus looking in the water, it's very rare that you get that fantastically detailed picture of yourself.
Where did she get that outfit from? Is that a Zara number?
Yeah.
Half a Zara number.
That is Echo. Looking at
he's going,
Narcissus.
I've got my boob out, look at me!
Look, you're not looking at yourself.
No, don't want to.
Here's a very...
It's right out, fully out.
Right. How do these scientists know how far away the moon is?
We measure how long it takes the light to get to us using a mirror thing.
Yes, but where's the mirror?
They put a mirror on the moon.
Five. They put five mirrors on the moon. Yep. Three American, two Russian were left behind by the various... There's one. Various manned Apollo missions, the unmanned Soviet missions. The very first one, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin, the first men on the moon, planted
it. Looks like a bit of fly tipping, doesn't it? On the way, you can get rid of fridge.
Yeah. Who's that there? That'll be gone in the morning.
Yeah. There'll be a mattress further on.
These retroreflectors, astronomers used them for 40 years to precisely measure the distance between here and the moon. So what they did was they fired laser beams from equipment in Texas and they timed how long it took to get there and bounce back again. And what they worked out is that the moon is moving away from us by about 3.8 centimetres per year.
It'll be back.
It's like the children.
Yeah, when it sees what it's like out there,
it'll be back.
Alarming if it was coming towards us 3.8 centimetres. They'd be there, wouldn't it?
It's the accuracy that you need from Texas to hit this mirror with a laser. It's comparable to using a rifle to hit a moving penny 2 miles away. It's the equivalent of measuring the distance between New York and Los Angeles to the nearest 0.25 millimetres. Now, for the part of the show which reflects poorly on everybody, general ignorance, fingers on buzzers, please. What's the best way to pull the pin out of a grenade?
Joe!
I
know they're going to go, woo-hoo. But I would love, if I ever throw a grenade, which I'm hoping I won't have to, but if I do, I'd love to go out with my teeth and throw it.
OK, so the classic design is that you hold the lever like that, you pull the pin out, and that is going to release the lever, and then you chuck it, it springs open, it triggers a time fuse, and boom. If you pull it out with your teeth, which they do in the movies, don't they?
Yeah.
Because they're busy firing a gun with the other hand.
They're busy?
Yeah.
God, I'm so busy firing this gun.
I know. You'd you'd be terrible in the army, wouldn't you? No, not now. I'm busy.
You've got such a lot on.
I know.
Bang, bang, bang.
Oh, bang, loud. Bang. The pin is bent so that you can't pull it out accidentally.
Oh.
So it isn't straight.
Ah.
The amount of force that you would need, which is between...
Hang on, will you?
Yeah. It's between 3 and 5 kilograms, at least, the amount of force could very well break your teeth. Yeah. So it is a complete misconception that you could at any time do this.
Adrian Charles.
If a grenade is thrown at you, what should you do? Should you try and throw it back?
Yeah.
Why?
Because it'll blow up over there.
There isn't time. I'd run if I was you. You've got 3 to 5 seconds.
3 to 5 seconds from lobbing it? Or...
From the moment the person has thrown it.
Because, like I said, I'm not much of a sprinter, more of a plodder, so you just wonder...
Yeah, from the moment the person has thrown it, you've got... Don't throw it back, that's the thing.
Don't throw it back.
That's rude.
Matt, leave it.
Leave it.
Leave it. Walk away.
Yeah. That's your last
quickly.
Thought.
Yes.
Sandy said, don't throw it back.
I've got time for this, I'm busy, actually.
What happens when you have a bump on your head and you wake up with foreign language syndrome?
Okay.
You don't speak in a foreign language, you speak in a foreign accent.
Clever.
Is correct. Clever. That's exactly right. You could just feel the trap door opening and closing.
Because if you could speak another language, then all I'd have done at school is just bash my head off the desk and go, oh!
Bonjour.
No.
Ça va? Oui, ça va bien. Merci.
No, it's just you to speak in the accent. Well,
why do you do that face?
I don't know.
I'm imagining smoking a Gaulois cigarette as well.
That's very odd.
Ça va bien.
Good.
Merci beaucoup.
What? It's just so weird how you turn into a cartoon. You're absolutely right. They simply have an impairment, a speech impairment. And the notion that they speak a foreign language, it's in the ear of the listener rather than in the mouth of the speaker. Sufferers have included George Michael. I don't know if you remember this. In 2012, he had pneumonia and he was briefly in a coma and he woke up with what sounded
You've got
like...
to have a faith. Rock your body.
No, he had a West Country.
Oh.
He had a West Country.
You've got to have faith.
A faith, you've got to have faith.
He had a careless whisper, he did.
Yeah. This is a terrible story. There was a Norwegian woman called Astrid L, and she was hit in the head by shrapnel during World War II in an air raid, and it left her with a German accent. But it was a speech impairment, and it resulted in her being ostracised by other Norwegians because they thought that she had somehow been associating with the Germans.
I heard someone on This Morning went on, they'd had some organ transplant, and when they woke up, they were really into vacuuming.
Well, so this is not as weird as it sounds. The answer may be that some memory exists in cells where we didn't know they resided before.
Wow.
That you would pass on vacuuming is really annoying.
Yeah.
If someone starts speaking French after a knock on the head, it probably means they're French. That brings us to the grim matter of the scores, which naturally are in reverse order. In last place, he should take a long, hard look at himself. With minus 13, it's Alan. With -7, it's Liza.
Thank you very much.
In second place with -3, it's Joe.
So close, so close.
In first place, it's an absolute miracle. It's astonishing. With 8 points, 8 actual points, it's Zoe. Thanks to Liza and Joe, Zoe and Alan, and I leave you with this from US comedian Rodney Dangerfield. I went to see my doctor. Doctor, every morning when I get up and look in the mirror, I feel like throwing up. What's wrong with me? He said, I don't know, said the doctor, but your eyesight is perfect. Thank you and good night.